Hello everyone, nice meeting you all. This is Tom from Experitest. We're very excited to see all of you who have joined us. We have more than 200 people on the call right now, and I'm hoping that in the next couple of minutes we'll get more and more peers who will join. Today we will conduct a session, Experitest, along with our partners, Gallop Solutions. In this session, we're going to talk about how to build or create a mobile application that is easy to automate, or in more general terms, test. So the main item of today's webinar is the creation of a testable application. How can you, with a collaboration of the developers, create an application which will be easy to automate and maintain the automation script? The session will be conducted by myself. I'm Tom. I manage Experitest sales department, and Rajesh, who is the head of delivering Gallop Solutions. Just a quick overview of Experitest and Gallop before we start. Experitest is a world-leading brand in mobile testing. We currently have more than 1,000 enterprise customers, people who choose to use our tools on daily basis in order to conduct, create, configure, and execute mobile testing suites on iOS, Android, Windows Phone, and BlackBerry-based devices. Gallop Solutions is a 10-year-old US-based consolidated independent software testing services with over 600-plus software test professionals in the United States and access to more than 2,000 test professionals worldwide. Rajesh, who will be accompanying me today in this co-webinar, is the Associate Vice President at Gallop Solutions. He leads the technology delivery department in Gallop, and with more than 17 years experience in testing or automation for desktop, mobile, and web-based applications. So before any further ado, we want to go ahead and start with the demonstration. I hope that you can all hear me, my voice properly and see my screen. Rajesh, are you here? Can you hear me?
Sure, Tom. Go ahead.
Okay. Hi, Rajesh. Thank you so much for joining. Let's get started with the presentation. We have quite an agenda to cover, and I think that it's most appropriate that Rajesh, you lead the first part and tell us a little bit about the importance of test automation and continuous delivery.
Sure. Thanks, Tom. Thanks, everyone, for joining this webinar. Thanks, Tom, for the introduction. So just setting the context of why test automation and how is it relevant in continuous deployment, continuous delivery sort of scenarios. We all are cognizant of the fact that test automation is a very, very important lever which will aid in continuous delivery. From the ages of regression testing, which was conducted in a waterfall model, we know that it will accelerate by cutting down the regression testing time. So your test execution time will be cut down, and that is going to drive the testing cycles lower and lower. You can save vital testing resources and cost, so your testing teams can now focus on improving the overall effectiveness of testing. Maybe you automate regression tests, automate your mundane tasks, so that you can allow your testing team to focus on the effectiveness of testing. And when we reflect upon how test automation can be done much better, one of the key aspects is to get a positive ROI. And if you start early, we all know that there is an umpteen chance to get a positive ROI. So you will have more regression cycles to test using your automation pack. So here is what we have to think strategically and see. How do we get the things done in the right way? And one of the critical aspects to do that or achieve that would be to focus on building testable applications. What do we mean by testable applications? Applications that can be easy to automate, that help you to adopt test automation much easier, and they don't become a bottleneck to roll out your automation packs. So we have seen umpteen number of times teams struggle to automate because the application under test has a lot of issues in terms of supporting automation. What I and Tom will do in the next hour or so is sort of give you good examples based on our experience, help you understand the nuances of how you can collaborate with your developers, and also present a case in a point where we have successfully done that. So, Tom, over to you.
Thank you so much, Rajesh. So now that we know on the, or we've educated a little bit on the importance of automation and continuous delivery, we want to start looking at, let's say, everyone knows that in today's development market, there is a new concept or term that refers to a DevOps team. And basically, what many development teams that work in an agile development procedure try to perform is to create a collaboration between the testing team and the R&D or the developer efforts. And they do that eventually, or one of the main reasons that they do that is because they understand the importance of testing and how will eventually this can contribute to the business ROI. Proper testing significantly reduces the amount of time that our development cycles, and proper automation helps to reduce these cycles even further. So I'm going to, today's session is a little bit more technical than most of the core webinars that we perform, and we've also targeted this session to an audience which mainly consists out of test automation engineers. I'm going to show today several different examples of the experience that we have seen during the past 3 or 4 years of creating and generating tools that allow test automation on mobile applications. And we'll talk a little bit about how can proper collaboration, communication between development and the test engineers can contribute to the testability of the application and the maintenance of the test cases that we produce. The first item that we want to discuss is on object recognition, and I know that most of you have many experience in trying to recognize objects or defining objects for your automatic scripts, and you've seen many times faced many difficulties in either figuring out how to define the specific elements or objects, or how to maintain a definition that you have created over time. So just a quick preview of on object recognition. Applications in the mobile realm usually rely on three main technologies, and we have native applications where the developers of the application use native components provided by the mobile operating system, Android or iOS, such as a button or a text view and so forth. We have web-based applications where we're basically reviewing a website, we're inputting a URL in Google's Chrome mobile edition or Safari mobile edition, and we'll work with web elements. And we will always recommend the development team or a DevOps team to try and heavily rely when he's developing an application on the utilization of native elements who are provided to you by the mobile operating system itself, or on web objects. Another type of development is the utilization of proprietary objects, where development teams are trying to create a fresh new set of objects that will react or behave in a different way than what native objects offer or web objects offer. And I'm sure that you've probably have some examples in mind right now. We will see some examples as we get on and proceed into the session. Our recommendation for you is to try and to avoid as much as possible from taking this option and rely on the capabilities of the mobile operating system or the capabilities that are offered by web elements and the way that they are rendered and behaved on a mobile browser. Mainly because if you choose to rely on the native capabilities or the web capabilities of these objects, it will be much easier for you or for an automation tool to know how to operate these elements, how to perform different actions of these elements, because they expose a set of methods that are familiar to automation tools themselves. And we'll see some examples today. So again, just to keep a little bit and discuss about the way that an application is rendered on the screen and the way that the elements are presented on the screen. Here's a mobile device that I have with me. An automation tool sees the elements as they appear on the screen as a tree of nodes. I'll open up the Citus Automation Object SPA, and you'll see that Citus Automation identifies all of the different elements that appear on the screen, and it populates for me in the object SPA the hierarchy, the way that the elements are contained within different containers, and the way that they are presented on the screen. Each node in the hierarchy represents a UI element that now appears on the screen. It has several different properties that, of course, can be used in order to defer an element from all of the other elements that currently appear on the screen. So let's say if I want to identify this icon over here, I can utilize its text or the value that is associated with the text. And then the automation tool eventually will be able to perform a click operation on the element by calculating the coordinates, the width and height, and clicking exactly in the middle of the element. So that's just a context to how basically do we work over here with an automation tool just like a Citus automation. And the way that we would like to create our queries, or the way that we would like to defer an element from the rest of the elements and interact with the element that we wish to identify and interact, is usually by choosing to work with XPath. XPath is a well-known query language that helps you to easily and in a very fast method search, perform queries on hierarchies or tree form structures. We can define a set of properties that we think defines the element in the best possible way and identify every element that gives a response to the query. We can formalize our query in such a way that we will get multiple responses to the query. Let's say that I'll search for each and every element that has a class that equals to UI view. As you can see, it filters just a minimal amount of the elements that appear on the screen and leaves most of the elements over here because they all share the same property. And before we continue, just a quick overview on XPath syntax for those of you who maybe have less experience working with XPath. Slash means that we're going to start from the root, from the main item in the tree. Star means that we're going to find or search for any node regardless of the specific name of the node. Then we're going to put some logical condition inside squared brackets. And at symbol signifies the properties that we want to use. As we continue, we'll see some more examples of XPath. So if you have any questions, you can feel free to write them in the questions bar and we'll refer to your questions during the session. So what happens when we have more than one element that matches this query? We've already seen a very short demonstration. If our query matches more than a single element that appears on the screen, we'll get a response for all of the different queries, for all of the different elements that react to this query or share the similar property. The way that Citest, our tool, works, let's say that I'll try to click right now on an element that has a class that equals to UI element. Citest uses the visual order. So that's the indexing that we will use, meaning that Citest will click the UI element that's located on the top left corner from all of the different elements that currently matches this request. So just FYI, for your information, this is how we eventually will decide which element to click on. Although we got 139 different responses to the query, we will click, our first response will be the element that's located on the top left corner. When you try to design an automation script, my first tip for you will be to create queries which return a unique identification. Your attempt or your goal will be to try and create queries in such a way that your query will define a single element and no other element that appears on the screen. This will help you to generate and create scripts which are much more robust and reliable. CTEST helps you do that by utilizing the XPA filter. We can see how many elements exactly matches our response. We're always or we're striving to get to a point which each query that we'll choose to utilize will only get for would only return a single response. Some considerations when you're trying to create queries that will define your elements later on. So considerations in object identification. You'll always need to consider whether or not the element that you're trying to recognize right now actually is actually visible on the screen. Because you're trying to create a functional test case, you're trying to simulate user actions. Users can only click on elements that are currently visible on the screen. CTEST offers for you multiple properties that can assist you guys in the understanding of whether or not the element currently appears on the screen. The on-screen property, for an example, just gives you a simple calculation for all of the different elements that currently reside within the screen itself. So it's X coordinate, Y coordinate, X and width and height calculation will formalize an element that appears on the screen. The top coordinate is a very, very easy or basic way for you to understand whether or not the element currently appears in the top of the screen. So what is the layer of the element? We'll talk about layering as we continue. A uniqueness, we've talked about it a little bit. A very strong feature that CTEST automation allows you is a unique XPath algorithm, where we can calculate based on the different properties that the element shares, what is the minimal expression that we can formalize and will return a unique expression. For those of you who are working with dynamic elements, elements that can change, they usually change text properties, we offer you also a way to retrieve an XPath expression, but to skip the text property. And in this way, you can even create a unique XPath expression with a click of a button, working with objects that are more dynamic in nature, let's say a balance in banking applications, for an example. You also need to ask yourself how common is the property. You need to consider multilingual support, so sometimes relying on text can draw an effect on testing applications that have several different languages that they need to support. You need to ask yourself and the development team, what is the stability of the property that you use eventually? This is a very important part of the automation process, just defining your test object. So the way that we'll identify elements is a process where you need to invest a lot of time into, because it will help you create a script which is much more maintainable and testable. How easy is the query that you create is also something that you should consider, mainly because these queries will eventually refer or reflect to the elements that we are working with. Many different team members, as our project gets bigger and more team members are joining into the automation project, will have to be able to read a single line. Let's say that a line such as click on an element that has accessibility labeled equals to watch is much more preferred than a line that tries to identify this element by a combination of unnecessary properties such as the following line, let's say for an example. So it's very hard for a person who now joins the project to understand what was the element that you've tried to define by choosing to work with this property. And we always recommend you guys to try to create a property which is as simple as it can get. And the parameters of the property gives you a short description of the element that you're trying to identify and to interact with. So here is some basic examples to common properties that we see. We will review a couple of them today. After this session, we're going to share a recording of this event, and if anyone wants, we can also share the presentation of this event. a property, but let's go over some basic examples. Accessibility identifier or content description should provide a unique description, or it's usually a unique property, which is from a non-dynamic form and supports multilingual. So a content description will also always appear in the English language, regardless of the fact on the text that appears on the element, such as accessibility identifier for iOS. It's a property that you should probably choose to use as automation engineers. The cons of this property is that it's not a required property from when you're creating a mobile application right now. So it's a property that needs to be communicated to the R&D team. One of the roles or positions as an automation engineer in the company is to convey these messages to the R&D team. You need them to allocate or populate for you the accessibility identifier or content description, depends on the mobile operating system itself, because it will make your life as automation engineer easier in the identification of your elements and the maintenance of your scripts. We'll share this table with you. I'm not going to go over all of these different properties right now, and later on we'll continue. So let's do a short demonstration let's try to review some applications that do provide a testable layout. So we're going to review right now some of the most basic applications, because eventually Apple developers and Android developers try to draw a line for the rest of the group, and they create their application in such a way where user experience is very important. We'll see some basic demonstrations, but also they keep testing and automation in mind. So if you'll open up any native application on an Android or on an iOS device, let's open for an example contacts and phone on iOS, and if I'll click on the object spy, you'll always see that the object spy is very clean and neat. You'll also see that it's very easy for me to create for myself a definition of an element. Almost each element that will be presented on the screen will either have an ID property, an accessibility labeled property, an accessibility identifier property that always gives a unique one-to-one description of the elements that currently appear on the screen. These properties will also be readable. It will be very easy for me as a person to understand what was the attempt of the test automation engineer, which element did he try to identify by the utilization of the ID that appears on the screen, the content description of the element that appears on the screen, the text that appears on the screen. It's something that's very easy for me to choose and automate with. Even elements which are a little bit more dynamic in form, like let's say lists that needs to adapt and contain different texts, they will also most likely have some sort of a description that defines this specific element. Why is this so important? Because now with XPath is a very powerful query language, I can easily create expressions that will allow me to search or locate only the elements that contain, for an example, a text property with 000 inside of it. So the first property gives me a general description of the element that appears on the screen, and I can combine this first property with several different logical expressions that will allow me later on to analyze the different elements that appear on the screen. This is very useful and helpful when I'm trying to iterate across very large number in lists. So the first tip that I can give you today to convey to your to your developers. We've talked about forcing them or trying to work with them and asking them to add for you an ID or an accessibility identifier or a content description for each and every element that appears on the screen. The name or the convention of the name should be a readable convention. I should be able to understand what was the element that I've tried to interact with only by going through or reviewing the code. When the developers create a proper and a testable application, a person can join the project and read a test case from bottom to top and understand exactly what was the purpose of the test case simply by analyzing the properties on which we've used to identify the elements. When you're trying to work with dynamic containers, also try to add to these dynamic containers an identifier that will give it a definition to the container itself. It will help with dynamic expressions. Later on, as we continue, we're going also to see some bad examples. We'll see some issues or developers who have done some malfunctions. We'll see these examples will always demonstrate multi-layers. As you can see, for Android and iOS applications, if they are developed in a proper manner and in a correct manner, I'm not going to see a lot of layering in my object spy. If I wanna, let's say, and we'll see later on how usually developers try to do like a page viewer construction. Usually, what they do is that they place the elements that they want to present to the user later on after, let's say, he clicks on a menu item. They hide the element that appear in the menu. We'll see that as we continue. So that's improper development, because it makes the life of an automation engineer much harder in the definition and description of its elements. We'll continue a little bit, and we'll talk a little bit on the next item, which is the importance of the creation of an easy mechanism for application navigation. We'll talk about it from a user's perspective, what's important from the user's point of view, but we're also going to talk and refer to this topic and subject from the automation engineer perspective. So for the automation to be successful, the operation that is built should be stateless. Try to avoid unnecessary stateful operations. Stateless means that it will execute any operation regardless of the current state or page. Again, we will see, or I can show right now, Android applications or some basic notions in Android development as concepts that really help with the automation of the application or the navigation for users. Android developers have introduced tabs that help with easy navigation. I can easily access each and every segment in my activity or my application, because these tabs are constant. It means that regardless of the location, wherever I am located on the application itself, I can always navigate to contacts, because contacts will always appear on the screen. Action bars is another concept that was introduced for Android applications and helps users and automation developers to easily navigate within or inside the application. The action bar will always appear on the screen regardless of the location of the user right now. And I can always access on the menu item over here and navigate to each and every section in my application. This helps both the users of the applications, but also the testers and the automation engineers. They can recover from scenarios by always accessing a certain anchor point in their application. They don't necessarily need to know exactly where do they reside or where are they located. They will always find a way to access the inbox, because these buttons will always appear on the screen regardless of the location of my application. So when you're developing an application, you should try, or when you're developing, I'm sorry, when you're developing an automation project for your application, you should supplement your project by adding navigation commands, which are common commands and will work in any state regardless of the location of the user. If you find this development or addition to the project hard, it usually means that the developers of your mobile applications themselves are not doing the proper job or not operating in the way that you guys want them to, but also the way that the users would like to work and operate with the software itself. Like next, we're going to talk a little bit about the UI components, layouts, and etc. I've briefly mentioned it as I've moved along or passed through this live demonstration. So there are two main issues that I want to mention and emphasize today. First of all, is the utilization of proprietary UI elements, and why do we recommend you to avoid the utilization of these customized UI elements? For this, we will need to review the way that eventually CTest automation operates and or works with the program. We have two different fashions in which we can interact with, and I'm talking right now like in general terms. It's not only CTest automation; it's every automation tool. If it's an open open source solution, or if it's a commercial tool. There are two different concepts of automating an application. One is by trying to understand exactly what appears on the UI, and this, like a very basic example for this concept, let's say is a tool that relies on image recognition and just clicking on the middle of an element or trying to simulate users' actions on the device. And that's a very common utilization, and it we utilize this concept as well. I'm sure that most of you have some experience in automation. I've seen several different examples in CTest. A function that can give you a good example is the swipe while not found function. So let's run the swipe while not function, and we'll try to swipe the device until we locate an element, and we'll use a native property that has a Argentina that appears on it. So I'm adding in CTest, and you can't see my screen because I'm operating on a different screen. I'm adding the command, and I'll try to identify this specific element, and we'll see right now how will CTest operate, how will it perform this procedure. One second, I'm sorry. So the main concept of the swipe while not found function is that I'm trying to simulate right now the way that a user will try to operate and locate this specific element. I'm swiping the list. I'm doing several different. Several different rounds where I'm swiping the list that currently appears on the screen, and trying to identify an element that has an XPath expression that equals to a text that equals to Argentina. And when I locate it, I'll click on it. In the swipe while not found, and I'll bring CTest over here to the screen for a second, I need to input several different parameters. One of these parameters is the swipe time. Now we can add lots of different logics in order to calculate what is the swipe time. The swipe time is the amount of time that the user's finger will actually touch the device when it's doing the swiping. But the utilization of this function is extremely hard, and the maintenance of this function is something that will be extremely hard for an automation engineer. And why is because that and the reasoning is because the devices or the screen sizes of the devices is extremely dynamic. It can easily change. The implementation of our application can easily change. And as you can see, as I change the amount of time that the user's fingers will touch the device, it changes the rounds that I need to perform in order to locate the element. It's a usable function. You've probably used this function or a similar method in order to navigate and identify elements within your application. But a function that I will recommend you to use in such a case is a function that we refer to or call to element list select. An element list select operates in a similar way to those of you who've maybe operated a little bit with Selenium and tried to do like a scroll to a operation on an element. And what it means is that we will be utilizing the API that was that's exposed to us by the developers of the of the mobile application itself, and will trigger a function right now that will pop, that will automatically bring for us the Argentina element to the screen. So I'm doing the element list select right now on the last element that appears on the screen, and I'll run this method. And you'll see that right now that the way, and you know what, let's not click on it, so you'll see how does it works. And you'll see that the Argentina element just pops to the screen automatically. It automatically brings this element into the view, into focus. So this method, or this way of operating, helps us to create a script which is much more maintainable. It helps me to create a script that can be executed or performed on a very wide range and variety of mobile devices and mobile operating systems. The principle is that we're using a command or a function that is exposed to us as an automation tool by the application itself. It is a public method that enables me to perform this action. The reason that we know that this function or this public method exists on the screen is because this element that we're trying to interact with is an element that is shared to the developers of the application by the mobile operating system itself. So the automation tool already knows which method or which API command should be call on the list itself in order to bring this element into focus. When developers create their own proprietary tools, an automation tool cannot understand which method should be called or presented in this specific action. So we don't know how to bring an element to the screen if you are using your own proprietary picker or list or table. So this is why we will encourage you to either extend, or we encourage development teams to extend existing components such as lists, scroll views, wheel viewers, and so forth, and not try to create their own proprietary implementation. Most of the methods that are required by development teams are already exist inside the mobile operating system itself, and if they used the elements and methods that are already exposed and available by the mobile operating system itself, Android or iOS, it will help the automation team to create a test case which is much more maintainable, because bringing the element into focus, either than trying to simulate user actions or calling the API command, is a much more robust method of operating on the mobile device screen, and it helps you to create a script which can be easily invoked on a very wide range of devices. So don't tweak your UI objects and events. Try to use rely on the events that are shared to you by the mobile operating system itself. The last concept that I'm going to refer to before I'll hand over the second part of the presentation to Rajesh is a complex layering, and we see it quite often with many different mobile applications. When developers are trying to create very elaborated screens which contains multiple pages and multiple views, usually a concept that they tend to work with or operate by is by layering the already pre-existing element. So here we can see that maybe this element still appears on the screen even after we've popped the menu item from the left bottom of the screen. An automation tool such as Citus Automation will identify this maybe element in both situations. What they did, the developers of the application, is that they've painted over the element instead of demolishing the element. if you'll open up Android native apps or Android applications that were installed, pre-installed Android applications on the device, the Google apps and so forth, you'll never see such a behavior. Google does not encourage you to take this approach. It has designated tools such as page viewers that can assist mobile developers to create applications which are clean and neat and easy to automate. The last demonstration that I will present before handing over to the next part of development is a demonstration of why do we think that a single team, the developers and the QA engineers, can operate together by utilizing our tools. One of the recent capabilities that CTest offers is the ability to perform a remote debugging session to devices that are located in the cloud. So CTest Cloud allows you to create a centralized environment where testers or developers can operate on a single unified set of mobile devices, enabling the testing team to fully collaborate with the developers of the application. In this demonstration, we see how an iOS developer can connect from his local Mac station to a remotely located devices stored on the cloud and debug his application on this device located on the cloud. An automation team can share these devices or share these reflections with the development team itself and working together with them in order to create and build an application which is extremely testable and eventually maintainable and will deduct to a significant ROI to the business requirement. So here we can see how the developer operates on the device, on the remotely located device from his local machine, and how he can add a watch to a specific variable that currently appears on the screen and review the properties of the elements. That was my part. Thank you all for listening. And I'm going to switch right now or hand over the next part of the presentation. We will review a case study where Rajesh will present for ourselves right now some of his experience in this field. Rajesh, are you ready?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Tom. I think that was really insightful in terms of the examples you brought forth, what sort of application practices the developers can do to help automation. So I would like to get a very relevant story here where we work for a large hospitality client. They had multiple challenges, by the way. The idea was to get automation shifted left, do it early, do it fast, build a large automation suite so that it can help them in continuous delivery of the applications. So the client had challenges in terms of, though he had a mobile application, his online presence was not too good. They wanted to increase their brand online. They were undergoing a transformation journey, both from a business standpoint, as well as trying to deliver software. So next slide, Tom. So what they had in terms of mobile testing was they had a single channel, the previous slide, Tom, which was the web, and they were focusing on the mobile channel, which was contributing in terms of their revenue, which was very less. So they wanted to increase their online presence from a mobile channel. They also had challenges in their current architecture that they were not able to support a wide variety of devices. And their current UI architecture was not scalable. So they had multiple challenges in terms of addressing the business. First, they had the challenge to reduce the lead time, optimize the delivery mechanism in terms of operational costs, and most importantly, from a customer standpoint, their current user experience, the feedback which they have received from the online forums, the stores, has been not so great. So they wanted to improve all of this, improve their brand and visibility. So moving on to the next slide, the client engaged us both in the form of test automation services and performance. And what they essentially did was they assembled a team of testing experts, which is Gallop, and also the dev partners, where we worked very closely with them in an agile fashion. The entire architecture had responsive design from a front-end standpoint and from a back-end. They decoupled the services, had some microservices as well, so that we could test some of these in a way that continuous delivery can happen. So Gallop was part of the agile teams distributed across, some of them co-located as well. So how did we address some of the challenges? So the other piece is, next slide, Tom. So the test automation team's objectives were carved out pretty much where we had to build an automation framework using C-test that can be easy to scale, so add more test cases as you go by, easy to maintain, and support reuse. And of course, every automation framework which we want to do would probably align to some of these principles, but it was a tough nut to crack, and I will tell you why in my subsequent examples. The other piece, if you see, was around having a unified framework which we could use, so that there were two sort of online presence, which is having a native mobile app and a mobile-friendly website. So we had to balance our framework to support both of these. And you would reflect nowadays with the plethora of devices, the automation framework and the scripts which we would create should support multiple devices. And even in future, when they wanted to add new devices to test, it should be completely scalable. So we put a framework which can do all of this as well. So moving on. So by now you would have understood that whatever some of the examples which was Tom quoting around some of the best practices, that's precisely what we hit as well. We sort of experienced as there were no object IDs, and in some of the UI elements, unique objects again. So what we ended up doing initially was we were spending a lot of time in constructing the XPath, trying to figure out what's the best way to sort of interact, because the testability of the application was very poor. And then, interestingly, we found that if the object IDs on iOS was X, then on Android, there could be X dash as well. And in terms of the other aspects which we never expected was the web and native flavors have differences in navigational sort of situation. So if you had to go from home to a check-in, there could be a couple of changes and nuances which are different in these two flavors. But still, we had to handle that. And finally, when we sort of got engaged with the developers and design teams, there were subtle nuances which the developers and design teams did not sort of acknowledge what impact it had on the test automation teams. In one of the situations which I could quote, they did some subtle changes to a build where we had automated some of our scripts, and that entire scripts had failed in the next build just because they had built some things in their framework which resulted in all the object IDs being different for the next build. So that's the situation sort of we were trying to handle. So if you move on, these are some examples. So when we engaged with them, if you see the snapshots which I have seen, we wanted to understand what's the unique element. If I had to check for the calendar, the dates, on the right side, you see the same sort of view. Even if it is disabled or enabled, there is no unique identifier which we can play with. And we had a tough sort of a situation where we had to work with the developers and design teams to impress on them that this is a lot of hard work if test automation has to be built from right scratch up. But I would say eventually it paid off by impressing on them. There's another situation which we had, and this was, if you go to the next slide, Tom. So this is something which we never expect. The left side of the snapshot, if you see, it's the same sort of application on iOS. There were navigational differences. And when we started off, while I was painting the big picture, our goal was to build an automation suite which can run on iOS and Android seamlessly. But when we started automation, and while we were engaging with early on, we saw that the design teams had a different view, and we saw these differences coming out. So that even the application navigation, the way it was built on Android or an iOS phone, were completely different. And some of the assumptions which our teams were making were sort of not right. And so these were, and there were some more examples for lack of time, can't go through them, but then these are some of the key challenges which we faced. And what did we do is to, if you can move on to the next slide, Tom, is try educating the design and development teams on the automation impacts. And of course, this was a lot of hard work, but the goal from our teams was to establish an automation pack which can run day in, day out on your CI, so that at the end, though we had initial hiccups, but when we started sensitizing some of these aspects, it had made our life easy. And we sort of, since it was a distributed team, we managed to establish the direct channels in terms of raising issues related to automation impacts. We were also getting plugged into the calls where we could voice our issues so that the development design teams can appreciate what we have done. Internally, from an automation framework standpoint, we made it highly configurable so that it can support multiple operating systems, form factor, navigational differences, so on. We also figured out that to make this scalable, form factor was a big challenge. And the way we used to certify our script is to execute the script on the lowest form factor so that we can finally say, yes, we are confident if the script would really execute. Otherwise, we had situations where when we moved from one sort of device, which was a high form factor, and then moved to a lower form factor, the scripts were breaking. And then that's when we realized that we had to really make sure that the lowest common factor should be tested first, and that's when we would certify and say the script is done. Finally, as a rule, as a practice, we were able to impress upon the design and development teams to actually start adhering to, if there is an issue with automation testability or even if it's regressed, then that build is broken, irrespective of whether the functionality works or not. We wanted them to correct, and that's when we proceeded. That's how disciplined we started moving in this space, and that's when we started seeing results in terms of getting a higher automation coverage, moving test automation early in the life cycle. So that, in a nutshell, what we had in terms of how we started engaging with the client, solving some of the challenges we faced while we go by. Over to you, Tom.
Thank you so much, Rajesh. That was the last part of the presentation. We have, let's say, 5 or 10 minutes for questions. I've answered most of your questions right now. Kalin, I'm just answering your question. The last question that you have on a page object model pattern, that's a very good question, and also I think that a recommendation that I'd like to give to each and every member that appears over here. Eventually, a testable application is not enough, and an automation framework or a good automation framework and project needs to be added in order to create a proper automation suite. A page object model pattern is a very common and very useful procedure that can help you guys to create a maintainable project, something that's easy to understand to the rest of the team mainly. CTS automation fully supports almost any automation framework or model there is, mainly because we chose to integrate our tool with a variety of programming languages and IDEs. So, Colin, I guess that you probably are experienced with one of the programming languages that appears over here, so you can eventually export the test automation scripts that you can create with CTest to a JavaScript-based version of the code, Vuegen, Ruby, Perl, Python, Java, C Sharp. We wrap them up for you with existing models such as JUnit, TestNG, NUnit, and so forth. We can send you templates or projects that already implement several different models, an application model, a page object model, and so forth, helping you getting started with the creation of your mobile application. So I'll write a quick summary of what I wrote in the answer. And if you have any other questions that you want to ask, guys, before we complete today's session, feel free to ask them right now in the questions box. Okay, if there are no other questions, I want to thank you all for joining me today. I want to thank my peers and colleagues in Gallop. Thank you so much, Rajesh, for sharing some of your experience working with our tools or designing an automation framework. Just one last question. There is a question if we have sessions on writing test automation frameworks. Yeah, in a matter of fact, we have several different sessions for basic or advanced sessions. You can feel free to contact our support or sales departments. I'll write it down right now, their email addresses. And we also have materials, existing projects that come with full documentation that follow known frameworks, procedures, and models in test automation. Thank you so much for joining us today. It's been a pleasure hosting the session. We had several different interesting questions. If you are interested in receiving the video recording of the session or the presentation that was presented, feel free to contact ourselves at Experitest or the Gallops team that send you the invitation to the session. Enjoy the rest of your week, and thank you so much. Thanks, Rajesh.